Tapping's a lot of fun, isn't it? Hey guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison from the Guitar Interactive, GI Plus. It's Monday. We're here to do the thing that we're doing on Mondays, which is hang out and talk about the guitar very quickly. Before we get too far into this, I just want to know, because we've got a couple of technical issues in our last couple of streams, let me know in the comments, can you hear my voice? Can you hear my guitar? Can you hear the backing track? Please say yes to all three, right? We're going to make it third time as a charm. Listen, hey, thank you so much for joining us. It's Monday evening. We're here to talk about tapping, and hopefully we're here to talk about tapping in a way that is not super, super intimidating and not super, super advanced. We'll touch on that stuff, by the way. You shredders out there, don't fear. We've got some stuff for you. But my aim for this lesson is for you guys who are maybe new to the idea of tapping. Maybe you do a little bit of it. Maybe you don't do huge amounts of it when you're playing. Maybe you're a little bit afraid of what happens when this hand comes on the fretboard. What do I even do? Well, this stream is for you. So, Nick, you can tap me a fiver into that. Yeah, very nice indeed. So, listen, I want to thank you for joining us. I love doing these streams. Monday evenings, highlight of my week. Love sitting around playing guitar for you guys. I love a little community of streamers that we have that join us every week. New friends, hey, it's great to have you on board too. We're going to tune in with the comments in just a second and see how everyone's getting on. First of all, though, before we do that, a couple of ways that you can help us keep the lights on, metaphorically and literally, over here at GI Towers. You can do the following. You can go to this URL right down here. If you can't see this URL for your play bar, depending on what platform you're on, the URL is guitarinteractivemagazine.com/GI-plus, where you can go to get more lessons just like this one. What I want you to do, right, if you click on the description, there is a URL down there, but there is a second URL that you'll find right at the bottom for an exclusive lesson that I'm going to share with you guys on this stream. And here's the cool thing. This is not even on GI Plus. It is just for streamers who are watching this evening. So we'll get to that, right? We will get to that. So anyway, listen. Yeah, somebody's been fooled by the thumbnail, says Andy racks the cam. Say, Andy, sorry you feel that way. Anyway, listen, a couple of other ways you can give us a thumbs up on whatever platform you're watching on. If you're watching on YouTube, you can give us a thumbs up. If you're watching on Facebook, you can give us a like, a love would be even better. You can share this with your guitar playing friends. We'd like to get this out to as many guitar players as we possibly can. Now, before we go any further, let's just check in with our little community of streamers. Let's see who's in the house. Of course, Marcin is the first one here. What did I expect? I didn't expect anything less. Marcin is always the first guy here. He is always the first one in, the last one out. A regular member and contributor to our streams, no less. Marcin's one of our beloved. He's been with us since day one. So if you're joining in for the first time, this is Marcin. Everybody say hi, Marcin. Foghornish is in the house too. Marcin's missed a comment here. I'm seeing Pliny. Oh, dude, yeah, that is a lineup. And then Gus G with Firewind, holy crap. Now, talk about a name that sounds really cool. A band name that's really cool in Greek and sounds less cool in English. But great band, great, great guitar player. Gus is just one of the boys, man. He's superb. So that's a hell of a lineup. That's really, really cool. We're getting a lot of love for Jack Gardner as well. We'll talk about that in a minute. Four Cornish in the house. Good evening, folks. I got beat by Marcin, who's first through the door. Looking forward to tonight's session. Hey, man, it's great to have you. You know, we don't judge on who gets here first in these sessions. As long as you're here, I'm a happy boy. David Yates is in the house. Evening, Nick. Evening, guys. That's an action-packed week of guitar ahead of you from our scene. 100%. I absolutely agree. Did anyone see Marty play with Megadeth? He was outstanding. What a special player he was. And he is. You know what? Like, that performance was something else. Did you guys catch it before it was taken down off YouTube? For those who don't know what we're talking about, Marty Friedman, who is considered by many, myself included, to be the Megadeth guitar player. Megadeth have had a litany of great guitar players. They're kind of like the Yardbirds of 80s thrash metal, 80s and 90s thrash metal, in the sense that you know, they had just this, they're almost like a college of exceptional guitar players. Who else has been like that? Whitesnake been a bit like that too, where they've just had loads of great guitar players one after another. David Lee Roth was like that. Chick Corea, like that. Just, that's great musicians in general. Zappa, David Bowie. Anyway, so yeah. Marty is considered by many, myself included, to be the definitive Megadeth guitar player, and they got back together on stage after like 30-odd years. It was at the Budokan in Japan, and it was phenomenal. Just outrageous. Marty really brought it. What a killer player. Absolutely fabulous. So yeah, if you haven't checked it out, you should check it out after the stream. Who else do we have? PJ, he's in the house. Fourth in the door, don't believe it. Man, yeah, PJ's normally second in. You got beat today, man, but that is okay. Listen, I'm just happy that we're here. St. Regard Slayer has a great question, which we are going to open out, right? So tonight's theme is, of course, tapping. So we want to know who are your favourite tappers? How are some of your favourite tappers of all time? Who are some of your favourite guitar tappers of all time? I have some suggestions, but Sacred God Slayer is in with two real good ones. There's Hi Nick. What kind of tapping spice do you prefer? Vito Bratter or Van Halen? Unusual phrasing or linear arpeggios? I don't like to discriminate because Ed is like, he's the guy that brought us the tapping thing, right? Wasn't the guy that invented it, obviously, but he is the guy that popularized it, certainly in the rock sphere, and also gave us so much of the stuff to but Vito was a very special player, still is, but was, you know, his work with White Lion was talk about the right band at the wrong time. I mean, like, geez, they should have been like enormous, like Bon Jovi level enormous, but they were just a little bit too late for the curve. And, you know, grunge happened. Not complaining. Some grunge bands that I absolutely adore. So, you know, I'm glad it happened, but poor White Lion, man. They deserved better than they got. And Vito was, he was on fire. Just outrageous. If you guys haven't checked out Vito Bratter, you absolutely should. However, I'm going to see your Vito Bratter, and I will raise you a Steve Lynch. Now, again, another right man at the wrong time. Steve Lynch was in a band called Autograph, again, in that late 80s, early 90s MTV period. And if you haven't seen Steve Lynch, not to be confused with George Lynch or Steve Morse, if you haven't seen Steve Lynch play the guitar, my God, prepare to be amazed. Running buddies with Jennifer Batten, if I'm not mistaken. There was certainly something going on there. Jennifer Batten's another, like, as guitar tappers go, outrageous. So we want to know who your favorite tappers are, but let's get back in with our comments. Let's see who's in the house. Who else do we have? Mark Randler's in. Hey Nick, hey guys. Nick, the first time I joined in one of these sessions, I noticed you were hybrid picking, and I asked if you had any exercise to practice it. Thanks for the last 2 weeks. Hey man, I'm really glad you got some use out of the last 2 weeks streams. I had a lot of fun talking about hybrid picking. Now, we did get a little off into the deep end on the first of our streams regarding hybrid picking, but last week was a little more, I guess, phrasing oriented with that stuff. So if you missed that, we have two streams on hybrid picking, which you can find on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. If you're not subscribed to us on YouTube, by the way, hit that subscribe button, because, you know, we'd love to hear from you. Absolutely love to hear from you. And we'd love to let you know when we're about to go live. So if you hit that bell icon, we can do that. Anyway, listen, who else do we have in the house? Larry Warren is here. Larry, it's great to have you on board. Larry's new to the tapping game, so hopefully we're going to give you some stuff that you can be working on today. Kim is in the house, Big Boss Kim, from a sunny locale, if I'm not mistaken, which is absolutely not what I can say about the UK. We're expecting snow this week, so grim. Get out while you can. Anyway, Timothy Appling is coming from Florida Keys, another sunny place. Timothy, it's great to have you on board. We got a lot of love for Jack Gardner coming in. Jack should have won the Guitar Idol competition a few years ago, but there was an audio problem. Now, Kim and I were talking about this a few weeks ago, about the Guitar Idol contest and all the great players that came through Guitar Idol. I want to know, by the way, what do you guys remember the Guitar Idol competitions? Did any of you follow them? I thought the Guitar Idol thing was absolutely fantastic. I got to judge one of them, the last competition that was run. I wonder if maybe that's something, you know, that should come back from the dead. Who knows? Anyway, listen, we'll get to that. Jack's a monster, no doubt. Absolutely agree. And a really nice dude as well. Jack's great. And a fellow Victory artist. He did all the presets for the, funnily enough, the Jack, which is not a Jack Gardner signature amp. It's a Guthrie Govan signature amp, but it's labeled the Jack. He did all the Two Notes presets for that. So very cool indeed. Keith MOF is in the house. Who else do we have? Jack is good and reminds me a lot of Satch. More on that in a second. David Yates says he's an exceptional player. He really stands out, a field full of shredders. Just got his own style, and what a style it is. Oh, for sure. Yeah, I can totally agree with that. Crank Tom's in the house. It is great to have you on board. A great place to be. I absolutely agree. Monday is working on his bad reputation. Oh, dude, yeah, I really like that. I'm having that. Just watched a video of Jack Gardner and wish I hadn't. Yeah, he's like, he has two effects on people. He either makes you want to practice or he makes you want to quit. So I'm going to encourage you to lean into wanting to practice. Steve McD is here with his PRS SE custom tonight. And you know what it is? They absolutely are amazing value for money. James, our cameraman, has one. It rips. It's fantastic. Keeps it in drop C, if I'm not mistaken. So whenever I'm down at the studio, I grab that for the heavy stuff. It's wicked. Rory Lisman is in the house. Rory, it's great to have you. Rory always has great insights on this stuff, so it's lovely to have you on board. I'm sure you've got some great stuff for us tonight. PJ, Fave Tapper has to be the guy that got me started. Alan Warner, that's an interesting choice. Very cool indeed. Okay, Mike Seedorf is in the house. Good to have you. Blue still in this year. I'm going to try and get through as many of these as I can. Secret Godslayer, glad there's love for Jack. He really deserves it. I totally agree. Totally agree. Cowcat is here. Mark McNish is in the house. Says, hey all. Hello all. Hey Nick. Some simple tapping ideas to get me started, I hope. Make sure I can go real slow. Maybe I can keep up. Fear not, my man. We're going to be treading on the simple side tonight. So it's not going to be anything like super crazy. Don't worry. Larry Warren says, I know very little about this topic. So much to learn. 100% agree. Lots of comments in the audio saying it's good. Thank you very much. Chuffed about that. You can get all of my lessons here, by the way. So go to this link. That's where you can go to get more GI Plus stuff. And loads of other stuff too. Fire, Wind and Soil Work for the title. Yeah, for sure. Like, not the greatest band names. I'm sure they mean something very cool in other languages, but in the UK, not so much. We've got a watcher on Twitch. Can you believe it? No one watches us on Twitch, but I think it's a bot, so never mind. That's one of those things. Oh, not to mention Ozzy. Of course, Ozzy, the college for good guitar players. 100%, right? So we're talking about good tappers here. We like Greg Howe Elevated EVH Rules. I can totally agree with that. Totally agree with that. David Yates is not a tapper, but my favourite is Ed, followed by Vito. We're going to try and fix the first part of that tonight. Totally agree with you on that. Guthrie's tapping is real. Guthrie's everything is unreal. Guthrie, but totally agree. Matthias Eklund, now that is a guitar player that does not get the recognition he deserves. A bit of love for Steve Lynch. Ooh, phenomenal. Who else do we have? Hammerhead by Steve Lynch is the song to check for sure. It's insane, just phenomenal, unbelievable. Stanley Jordan. Of course. How do we miss Stanley Jordan? Double-handed jazz tapper. Amazing to see. Like, Eleanor Rigby in 1986. Like, Jesus Christ. You know, I saw a guy comment on that video saying, amazing playing, terrible tone. I'm like, it's a rip off of VHS. Of course the tone is terrible. Never mind. I'm glad our comment section is filled with good people, because some of them aren't. Anyway, so yeah, phenomenal. And on that note, in terms of like eight finger tappers, an early rock pioneer for that stuff, Jeff Watson from Night Ranger. Absolutely. Well, would you look at that? Jonathan McCullough, Jeff Watson, Night Rangers, bonkers tapping for sure. Obscure Guitar by Skip Newman, probably my favourite username. Hey Nick, what should I cover with a student who can do the tapping interruption but wants to use the technique in their improvising? You should cover the stuff that we're going to do today. You can have this for free and then direct them to the stream and they can watch it for free. But no, the stuff we're going to cover today will be appropriate for that, I think. Or I could raise your Steve Lynch with TJ Helmerich for sure, and like, while we're on that subject, Chris Broderick. Tapping all around. We're just... Dave Kay. There's so many great tappers out there. Who else do we have? I think he'd be multi-discipline music ninja warrior course, Mortal Kombat and chess to finish. Fabulous. I love Dan Smith, right? We bumped into each other very briefly at the guitar show. I think it's one of these things where we're just like flying visits. I gave him a cuddle just out of the blue and I'm like, hey, Dan, it's great to see you. And then we just went off our separate ways because that's how the guitar show goes. Good question here. Hi, Mr. Nick. What are your thoughts about tapping in other strings other than the first string? The first string can still play just from the wrist or need to add the flick because the tone is not the same. A very good question. I am going to star that up. Right, we're going to answer that a little bit later on. Don't forget, we're answering your questions a wee bit later on. Who else do we have? John Myung is... Oh, it's Liam. Of course it is. This is my bass player in Blitzkrieg. Hi, Liam. How are you doing? It's great to see you. Of course, John Myung is there. Liam was this far away from John Myung not that long ago. And, like, so good. Like, it made him ill. It was that good. So, anyway, does Tony Levin on the stick count as tapping? I would say so, for sure. Segovia and some Spanish players were caught tapping. I mean, yeah, for sure. Segovia... the man. Who else do we have? Ross Andrews. Hey Ross, it's great to see you. I'm a drummer and love watching these videos. You know, it's funny that I love watching drum videos. So I'm addicted to Drumeo at the minute. So hey, really into that. So listen, anyway, we've talked a lot. I want to share something with you guys before we go any further. This is a free lesson that I'm going to share with you, right? I was digging through the GI Plus archives to try and find a lesson that's appropriate on tapping, and I came across this one. This is not currently on the site. right? So you can't go to the GI Plus site and find this. This is just for people who are watching this stream. You will find the link in the description down below. This is an exclusive two-hand tapping lesson from Danny Gill. Now, we have loads of great tap lessons from Rick Graham, Martin Goulding, Andy James, Michael Caswell. Who else? There was loads of great ones out there, but this one kind of stuck out to me, mainly because it's so good. And it's not on the site because it doesn't really belong in a series particularly. It was just kind of a lesson all on its own. And it seems a real shame for it to go to waste. So you can get this lesson down below. Here's the thing. People who are GI Plus members, if you're a GI Plus member, you'll be able to access this lesson at this link forever, right? However, if you're a non-GI Plus member, we've taken the brakes off this lesson for this week. And this week only, we're going to be shutting this lesson down for non-members after a week. But for this week, you can get this lesson for free. Here's a little snippet. This is Danny Gill on creating a solo using two-handed tapping. When we come back, we're going to be discussing how you can use tapping in your playing.
All right, in this lesson, we're going to talk about how to create a solo guitar piece using two-hand tapping. This is something that Joe Satriani has done so successfully on songs such as Midnight and A Day at the Beach. I'm going to go ahead and play through an example of this style, and then we'll come back and we'll talk about the technique. All right, so let's talk about the technique. First thing, don't need the pick, put the pick away. There it is. Just in case we need it, I'll have it close at hand, but we're not going to need the pick for now. Now, let's grab a chord. How about a G chord? I'll play a G bar chord.
To get the rest of that lesson, you can go to this link, right? Go find that link. If you're a GI Plus member, right? Bookmark this link because it will be there forever. If you are a non-GI Plus member, if you're not a subscriber, that's cool. We're glad to have you on. You don't have to be a GI Plus subscriber to be part of these streams, but you will only have a week to access this lesson, right? It is not something you can find on the site. This is a stream exclusive. So there you go. A gift from me to you. Anyway, listen, let's talk about tapping. So I want to dispel some myths about tapping before we go any further. First of all, there is this idea that tapping is somehow some kind of crazy advanced technique that's only for, like, big ol' shreddos, like myself. You know, I like a bit of a shred. It's absolutely not the case, right? Tapping is a technique that is accessible to guitar players of all levels and is something that is useful for all manner of kind of, like, cool melodic and even chordal kind of textures. But we're going to focus on melodic stuff today. So I want to begin by talking about what a tap is and what a tap isn't. A tap is not, we just have to head this off at the pass, right? A tap is not what it sounds like. It sounds like, by the name, that we're tapping on the string as if we were, like, tapping on a desk. It's actually not that. A tap is, with the right hand, a hammer-on and a pull-off, just like we would do with our left hand. So if, for example, we took a phrase, we're not going to do the classic Eddie Van Halen phrase, but let's say we took a phrase that was on the 7th and 10th frets on the high E string, we could play the 7th fret, and then we could hammer on to the 10th fret by striking the string so that the string makes contact with the fret. That's how it works. String makes contact with fret. It's not the sound of our finger hitting the string that makes the sound, it's the sound of the string striking the fret. So we can think about it as a strike, which we then hold in place to make the note ring out. So let's do that first of all. So we have 7 to 10. I'll turn the delay off because that's a little bit annoying. We'll come back to delay in a second, because delay is fun. A pull-off is going to be the opposite, but we don't just lift our finger off. What we do instead is there's a couple of ways we can do this. We can do it with a brush, which is where we use the friction of our finger to graze the string, but the string itself doesn't move terribly far. It's just a brushing action. So let's try that first. Let's play with third finger and brush to pull off to the first finger. Grab your guitar if you haven't already, because I want you to play along with this. This is important stuff. So next thing we can do is we can pull off using a pluck motion. Now, a pluck is a little more athletic, and we can't sustain it for quite as long, but it does have a cool tone. Now, the pluck is where we grab under the string and really yank on it, and we get this kind of sound. He's got a very different kind of tone to our brush. Our brush is very smooth. Our pluck has a real kind of like meow to it, as Alan Holdsworth would refer to it. So there's hammer on, here's pull off. Here's hammer on, then pull off. We can do exactly the same with our right hand. Now, Blue Sumlin has a question here. There's what finger is best for tapping? I default to middle finger. I know lots of people use index finger. I don't think it makes a huge difference. I default to middle finger for one tap on this on a given string. But what I will do is I'll use my other fingers, my third finger and my fourth finger in particular, to add taps on top of this. That's another story for another day. I like the middle finger. The reason why I like the middle finger is, you guys can see what's going on here, I can hide the pick in the crook of this. Excuse my calluses on there. There's some lifting calluses for you that I've recently sawn off. But I can hide the pick kind of in here, if that makes any sense. So that, to me, well, it has refocused. Hooray. Thank you, Sony. So I like to do that because, again, it gives me something, somewhere I can hide the pick. I find it a little more cumbersome to hide the pick here in between these two fingers. You may be saying, well, why hide the pick at all? Why not just hold it and tap? We'll get to that. So for the time being, anyway, whichever finger you prefer, totally up to you. We're going to take the 10th fret. We're going to fret that. And then with whatever finger we want from our right hand, we're going to perform a hammer-on, which again is just bringing the string forcefully into contact with the fret. That's how we do it. So we don't bring our finger into contact with the string. That's not what makes the sound. What makes the sound is the string hitting the fret. And then we pull off with the same motions. We can either brush or we can pluck. They both have sounds. Now the brush sounds very smooth. Our pluck sounds very aggressive. So the cool thing about this is because we don't tap quite as many notes as we do hammer-ons and pull-offs in our phrases normally, we can pluck with a tap more often than we can with a brush, than we can with our left hand. So if I try to pluck, oh jeez, a big pull-off run, that is very hard to do, right? I run out of steam real quick. Whereas if I try and tap something quite drastic, and I try and pluck all of the taps, I can do that because the tapping finger is not really doing all that much stuff. You know, there's not that many notes out there. So that is the core mechanics of tapping. Now, we're not going to start with the shreddy stuff just yet. We're going to get to that. But what we are going to do is we're going to begin by using tapping for a very cool and interesting and obvious phrasing use, which is reaching for notes that we can't get with this hand. Here's the thing, right? I have quite big hands, and I can conceivably reach from here, to about here, even here. Ah, that's a bit uncomfortable. But it starts to make these fingers kind of cramped and weird. It's also a bit of a pain. It takes a bit of forethought to get up there. But what I can do is I can reach with this finger, quite comfortably. To grab notes that I wouldn't normally be able to grab with my left hand. That is how we're going to begin by approaching this stuff. We're going to begin by using this as an extension to our left hand reach. So we're going to talk about some phrasing ideas for that. You'll see me do this fairly regularly, where I'll actually reach for like some big tap notes up here. I threw the delay on for a bit of love, as a way to mask the jump from one like one part of the fretboard to the other. So I might do like stuff like this. The delay is very big now. That little tap slide thing, I'll do that all the time. It's just one of those kind of like break glass shred licks. But here's what we're gonna do. So rather than like get too crazy with this stuff, I'm gonna give you a handful of notes, pun intended, to play with your left hand. And then I'm gonna give you a handful of options to play with your right hand. We're gonna jam together on this. So the way we'll do this is we're gonna begin by playing, here are some options. We're gonna play 12, 14, and 15 with our left hand, and then with our right hand, we're gonna play 19, and then we can play 22 if you want. 22 is cool. Can you talk to the bending thing? I will absolutely talk to the bending thing. Fear not, we're going to get to that, but a little bit further down the line, we'll get to that. So the tapping and bending thing's really, really cool. And it's actually way more useful than the tapping and shredding thing, I think. So anyway, so we have 12, 14, 15, 19 with the right hand, and 22 with the right hand. We're going to begin by searching for some phrasing ideas using just these notes. Now, the way you might pick these is you may play with a plectrum and then try and sound all the notes with pull-offs and hammer-ons. And we're going to try and search for some cool ideas that we can play using these notes as a melody device. So, you'll notice we're not doing anything really athletic with the tapping yet. We're not doing this. The lick that should not be, we'll get to that. You're allowed to play that if you're playing Van Halen songs and nothing else. Maybe the solo from one. Anyway, so here's a track. We're in E minor. I'm going to play a little bit, and then I'm going to give you some space to play too. So grab your guitars. So if I begin with this, I want you to take a turn and see what you can come up with using that tap note and these left-hand notes. Think about contrasting this note against this hand, or this note against a few notes in this hand. I'm gonna let you take another pass in a second. Let me give you some ideas. So I might go. Ten is also very good fun on the high E string too. So we can have that as well if you want. You throw that into the mix, why not? We're playing an E minor here, by the way, just in case you're wondering. So those of you who are like, hey, what does this supply in terms of intervals? There's our root note. I'm gonna go again. I'm not going to make you play in this gap, but you can go right now. Here we go. That's a nice bit of space. Some shred in the backing track. I'm going to do the same thing. So I'm going to go like this. Got a bit carried away with myself there. What else is new? My turn. That's a little bit further ahead. We'll talk to that in a second. Your turn. You can go right about now. I'm coming back into the main cam. I'll let you finish. I feel like Kanye West. I'm going to let you finish. There we go. We're going to stop that there. So this is an example of an introduction to a melodic approach to tapping, where we take a handful of melody notes, and we don't really worry about playing anything crazy fast or anything like super outrageous or any of that sort of stuff. We just use the tap as a way to reach a high note that we otherwise wouldn't necessarily be able to grab. Marcin has got it absolutely right. It is the modern prog ballad in the key of E minor. I'm going to go find this backing track. while we're on, it's available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. We're actually having a bit of bother with the backing tracks on GI Plus at the minute on the site, but that's okay because all the backing tracks are available for free on YouTube. So I'll find that backing track. I'll drop it in the link in the comments as we go. So I'll find that active backing track. So I'm going to go digging with this as we go, and I'll pop a link down there because Rick is absolutely right. The backing track would be useful. Nice job. Hey, thanks, man. I appreciate it. Would you look at that? It is the top result. So those of you who want the backing track, I'm about to post it in the comments. It is right here. There you go. So get the backing track at this link. You can go and get it for free. And it's me playing this guitar in this room. Hey, who knew? What are the chances? So anyway, we're going to get rid of that. Now, let's extend this a little bit further. And we're going to start talking about the idea of using tapping to be a little more, I guess, a little more expressive with our note choice, because just reaching for these notes, that ain't no fun. So yes, we can play all sorts of cool athletic stuff with tapping, and we'll get to that in a second. We will actually talk about that. May end up being next week at this point, but who knows? We will get to that. But I want to show you a little bit on how to make these notes sound a little bit less like this. A little more like this. Just having a little bit of a noodle there. So what we're doing here is we're applying some expression to our tap notes to make them sound more interesting and to give us a bit of time just to live on that tap note for a while. Now, here's a big mistake people make when they start to play with tapping and vibrato and stuff. They start to do it with the right hand. Now, you'd be forgiven for thinking that because when we do vibrato with the left hand, it happens with the left hand. When it's time to do tapping and vibrato with our right hand, yeah, you do it like this. Not so much. This is not the way to do tapping vibrato. And certainly not the way to bend. It's very awkward. We end up with all sorts of like ringing strings. It ain't good. So what I like to do instead is I like to use my left hand to apply the expression, and then my right hand almost resists the string. Let's do this together. Let's take the third finger on the left hand, and let's play some vibrato on the 10th fret of the B string, like this. We're also then going to tap on top of this the 15th fret on the B string. So 10, then 15. What I want you to do is I want you to use your tapping finger to hold the string in place. Just hold it in place and literally like resist the vibrato in the left hand. Apply the vibrato with the left hand, use the right hand to actively resist it. Now what we can do is we can do this sort of thing where we tap and we do some little bends. That is not something that we can very easily do with our fingers. Try playing that lick. It's really hard. Can I do it? It's a lot messier, a lot less kind of like, I guess, you know, a lot less liquidy or leady, I suppose. Now, that is a cool thing in and of itself. So that's some vibrato, which is really good fun. But what we can also do with this is we can start to bend with our taps. Now, again, the bend... here's an interesting one. My pitch sounds bad while doing this. That is practice. Now, this kind of gets into the bending thing in general and how bends work. So when we bend, there is a common misconception that we bend on muscle memory and that we bend a fixed amount to go a fixed distance. That's actually not true. What we do is we bend using our ears, not like this, not literally ears going in there, but we don't press a fixed amount on a string, to go a certain distance with a bend, because all of our strings even on the most balanced string set, are different tensions. And, you know, at different points on the fretboard, the string is more or less tense. It's less tense here than it is here, for example. So we're not really like going on muscle memory with this. What we're doing instead is we're going on our ear. We are listening and reacting to the pitch that we're bending to. So we have to have a very clear picture of where it is we're trying to bend to. I will say, however, though, that if this is a new technique, sometimes there's a disconnect there. When you start bending and you start trying to react to the bend, things start going a little bit weird. So what I'm going to say here, here's another little technique with this. So we've talked about resisting the vibrato. That's a fun thing. When we bend, we don't so much resist the bend as we ride the bend. The bend comes from the left hand, but the right hand just goes along for the ride. So we do this sort of thing. So here's little bends with some resistance. That works really well. Notice even though I'm resisting, the finger is being moved. But for actual bends, the right hand comes along for the journey. Like up here. Now, to be super clear about this, the left hand is the one doing the bend. If I do this, that's a tone and a half bend. I'm doing this. That chokes out, but you get it. That is a tone and a half bend with this hand. This hand is doing all of the bend. This hand is just there. It's almost like a capo on top of our bend. Now, that's really cool because we can do these kind of huge bends that we couldn't normally do with, it'd be a struggle to play something like that. That would be a challenge. Very difficult to do, whereas this is really cool. And not only that, but it's given me some space to get my left hand up here and play something interesting. That's quite cool. So we're going to get onto the bending thing for a minute, because that's good fun and it's something people ask about. So let's do some tapping and some bending. Let's do some examples together. What we're going to do for this is we are going to play the following places on our fretboard. We're going to tap on 15, sorry, that's not 15, that's 17, 19, 20, and if you have it, 22. You should have 22. Why do guitars have 21 frets? We'll never understand this. 22, I absolutely understand, because the neck pickup goes in a specific place. 21 frets, you're just losing a fret. The pickup doesn't move. It's already in the right spot. Don't understand it, right? I know it's because Leo did it, but whatever. So if you have a 21 fret guitar, power to you. You do not need the histrionic extra 22nd fret, but still. Anyway, what we're going to do, we'll play these notes, and then I'll show you some bends on them. So if we begin, again with our left hand, we can play 12, 14, 15. And then with our tap, 17, 19, 20, 22. So let's just do some stuff with that first. Let's go. Now, some bends. We can bend each one of these up to the pitch of the next note that we're going to bend to. So this one's a tone up, so we can bend this note up a tone. And again, the bend happens with our left hand. Same with this one, we might bend it up a semitone, that's 19 up to 20. We may bend it as far as 22, which is a tone and a half. Or we may do 20 up a tone. So on and so forth. Now, that's some examples from tapping and some bending, but we don't have to do this with any degree of exclusivity. You can just drop it in as a single thing in the midst of a solo, because it's quite easy to do. So let's say, for example, you were soloing and you found yourself somewhere up in this territory and you decided, you know what? I'm going to put a tappy bend. Ah, here's a cool thing, right? Can you take your tap finger off to leave you in a pre-bend? Yes, you can, and it sounds cool. It sounds like this, like this. Let's find one that's going to work, so... That sounds really cool. That might be better if you plan ahead. We can go there. So that might be really fun. Loads of fun. I mean, yeah, you absolutely can. It sounds really cool. Now, more importantly, Hank, this is the kind of thinking that I want. We're being creative with this now. We're not just a slave to some licks. No, it's at no point have we done anything like super crazy. This is just melody stuff. But it'll transform your playing, and it will get you acclimated to doing this tapping sort of thing. Now, talking about just throwing a pitch in, let's say, for example, you're soloing somewhere around, I don't know, you find yourself up here and you're phrasing away. And you want a high pitch. That sounds fantastic, right? Really, really cool. Here's another one. This is a really great one from Mustache Metal. Again, one of my favorite usernames. You can do the Alexi Laiho thing of playing a massive bend and then grabbing a quick tap and pull off while the string is fully bent to release. Totally can. So you can do this sort of thing where you may go... Which sounds fantastic. If you do it on a repeated bend, you get like a harmonica kind of sound. You blues hands out there who want a bit of the... that's another story. That's licks. We're not here to do licks, but that is very cool. For expressive use, can I suggest the old Vi trick to tap a note with the right hand, then quickly slide up the same fret with the left hand for sure? I really like doing this not to the same fret, but that would work, but to the... Obviously it would work. Steve Vai doesn't. Steve Vai's a genius. I like doing it to like the next scale tone below. So what we might be talking about here, let's do some Lydian because it's Vi. Got a bit carried away there. It was like more Lydian than Lydian. That's not Lydian. That works really well. It's a very, very cool thing. I like to do it as a way to find my way a little further up the fretboard. So I might be playing, I don't know, maybe something like this. Where I'll slide up, I'll tap. I'll maybe bend into the next note before, or like I can even get all the way up here, so I could be somewhere down here. It's a cool way just to make these massive interval jumps, but also to give myself time to figure out where I'm going with it, which is good fun. So this is the cool thing about this, right? You guys are thinking creatively about how you might use this tapping stuff. It's just like, that's gold. When you start thinking about it in these terms, when you start thinking about it as, here's just a way that I can put my finger on the string and make a cool note, you've won the game, right? You have won. And then it's just a case of, like you do with your left hand, you know, anything that sounds cool fast should probably sound cool slow. We just take the same ideas and we speed them up. So for anybody who wants like a fun, shreddy thing to do with this, one of my favorite little techniques is to do the, this is maybe a little bit advanced, but is to do what I think of as the Jordan Rudess bend. So if we think about Jordan Rudess, keyboard player for Dream Theater, he would do this very cool trick that a lot of keyboard players do. I just think about it as Jordan because I'm a bit of a Dream Theater fan, where he would hit a note and then dip the pitch bend wheel. So it would go wee wee. And he'd normally do it at the top of like a crazy run, just like crazy, crazy, crazy run. So what we might do is we might take something like an E minor pentatonic thing. For those who are interested, what I'm doing here is I'm going to play the pentatonic as minor third. We're getting way off in the deep end here, by the way, but I'll do one quick. So minor third, fourth, fifth, tap the flat seven, tap the root. So the root is here. Looks like the way the black keys in a keyboard laid out. So we have two together, three clustered together. It's because the black keys in the keyboard spell out the pentatonic scale. We might do that. It's a two-finger tapping thing. So there's G, but I'm thinking about this as like an E minor pentatonic. So what I may do is I may do something like this. So we go again. And you can hear that. I might do here as well. Quite hard to do clean. And what I'm doing there, for those who are interested, is I'm tapping, and then pulling off from my previous tapping finger, hit the big old bend, and away we go. Now, that is some really advanced stuff for this. You don't need that, but, you know, you may want it. If you want it, it's there. We'll do questions in a second, by the way, because we've got some great questions coming in. I want to make sure we definitely get to it, but I want to just highlight a couple of them that we'll be talking about in a second. So, Mal Riley says, do you know the Eric Johnson riff where he fingers a chord and taps each note 12 fret up, making a harmonic for each? Yeah, that's a little different. That would be something like this, where we actually tap the harmonic. So that's probably another story for another day, but it's a very cool technique. We can talk about piccolo register stuff another time, by the way, where we do, if you guys are interested, where we can do this sort of thing where we might play. I had this weird technique I played with for a while, and I haven't done it in ages. I'm going to do it on stream because we take risks here. But I had this mad idea of playing with. It's hard to do if you're not used to it. Oh, concentrating. I have to get good at that again. But I had this crazy idea of like doing touch harmonics rather than tapped harmonics, literally just touching the string and then fretting legato notes with the left hand. It's a bit weird, but it's good fun. Maybe we'll talk about that another time. Here's a good question from Timothy Appling. I used to think you could only tap certain notes when tapping, but now I see you can tap any note if it sounds righteous. Is this correct? That is absolutely correct. You don't need a pattern. You don't need to just reach a particular. If the note is something that you would play with your left hand, you can play it with your right hand and vice versa. You know, if you play with your right hand, you play with the left hand. If it's down here, you can do that too. You know, if you decide, if you're up here, you decide you want that note, go get it. Missed it, but you get the gist of it. So yeah, you're absolutely correct, man. You know, you can tap any note as long as it sounds cool. There's no maximum limit or minimum limit on how many times you can tap a note. There is no there is no limit to saying you must put the pick down, engage in tapping, grab the pick again. We don't need to worry about that. So anyway, listen, there's a bunch of great questions. I want to make sure we get to them. So in a moment, we're going to be taking your questions. Before we do, just want to take a quick second and remind you that if you're into your technique stuff, if you want to learn a little more about the old choppy choppies, if you want to do some stuff with a pick, which you should do, this is the course for you. This is Pick and Strategies, part one. When we come back, your questions.
Does your picking feel uncoordinated and sometimes you miss notes or fluff transitions from string to string, maybe a little bit like this? When in reality what you want is smooth and easy and transparent feeling picking, a bit like this. Or maybe you've been sold on the idea that there's one specific way that you have to pick on the guitar and everything else is wrong, but that particular cookie cutter approach just doesn't work for you. It feels unnatural. It almost feels like you're fighting your own body to try and make it work. Well, Picking Strategies Part 1 is the course for you. Okay. In this course, we explore the many different ways that you can form a full and complete and comprehensive picking approach by examining the various strategies used by some of the greatest pickers of all time. And there are a whole bunch of strategies out there, and I guarantee there is one that is going to work for your preferred picking mechanics, the way you prefer to stand or sit with the guitar, the type of guitar you play, the type of music you play. There is a strategy for you. We're going to explore all of them, and I'm going to show you how you can take a single solo study and play every line within it using all of the six picking strategies that we look at in this course. And of course, this entire course is available as part of your GI Plus membership. So if you're not signed up already, what better excuse do you need to sign up today?
So, that's Picking Strategies Part 1. You want to get into the picky thing? That's available as part of your GI Plus membership. GI Plus members, you know where to go if you're interested in signing up for GI Plus, where you can get all of my courses. I mean, all of them. And so, near enough all of them anyway. There's, I think there's two on Lick Library. But all the other ones, they're in GI Plus. You can go and get them at the link down below. And also lessons from Andy Wood, Andy James, Rick Graham, Michael Caswell, Tom Quayle, Giorgio Cerchi, Lewis Turner, Michelangelo Badio. Who else do we have in there? Drawing blanks, but Danny Gill, of course. And don't forget, by the way, we have that exclusive Danny Gill lesson, which is available only to streamers. So in case you've just tuned in, we are giving you guys a free lesson today, right? A free lesson. You can go to this link down here, where you can get an exclusive lesson from Danny Gill. It is currently available to both members and non-members. It's going to be available for a week on this link. You will not find this on the GI site. It's an exclusive lesson that is just available at this link. So it's stream only. Now, if you're a stream viewer and a GI Plus subscriber, if you're a GI Plus member, you'll get this lesson at this link forever. However, if you are not a subscriber, you've got a week to go through this lesson, and by the time we are streaming next week, it's going to be gone. So yeah, click that link, exclusive Danny Gill lesson on two-handed tapping. Go get it, it's really, really cool. So anyway, we got some questions, some really nice comments coming in as well. I really do appreciate you guys taking the time to let me know that you're having these little breakthrough moments. So I'm really into that, right? So Larry Warren's had a very, very cool comment for us. Says, thank you, you've opened some cool doors. Thanks for clearing this up a bit. Man, you know, I really appreciate you saying that. Tapping is one of those techniques that people like to make very mysterious. Even its name is mysterious. It's like tapping. What is it? You're doing hammer-ons and pull-offs with your left hand, with your right hand. That's all it is. It's a disappointing moment. I had a similarly disappointing moment when I was at college, and I always use this with my own students, where we talk about that, is that it moment, where you go, is that all that was? Yeah. I remember learning about, I was looking at the syllabus for year two music theory when I was studying, and one of the things that was in there was all sorts of stuff. It was like secondary dominance. Whoa, what's that? You know, modes of the melodic minor. I'm like, oh my God, this sounds amazing. What was the one? Oh yeah, the one that stuck with me was X chords. And I'm like, what is an X chord? I need to play one of them. I need to know how to play X chords. Turns out, an X chord is Nashville numbers language for turning a major or a minor chord into a dominant chord. That's what it was. I'm like, that's what X chords are. Yep. Yeah. It's disappointing, but also like, hey, I know how to do that now. That's pretty cool. Same with tapping. You go, wait a minute. It's just hammer-ons and pull-offs with the right hand? Yep. that's all it is. But it opens up a load of cool possibilities for you. So I'm really glad you're getting some use out of that, my man. Very, very kind. Quick question from Mark Crandall. There's learn the first solo and picking strategies. Later on, does it talk about hybrid picking and tapping or legato? It does not, but hybrid picking is coming in a future instance of picking strategies. So keep your eyes peeled for that. The legato and the tapping thing, we may do a course on that at some point, because I feel like that's something that doesn't get talked about enough. If you want some of that for the time being, we've got some great Tom Quayle lessons. Hey, just saying. But expressive techniques, it doesn't talk about it in expressive techniques, that although there is some stuff on legato and not so much tapping, but there is expressive use of legato and expressive techniques. So sure. Got a question I want to flag up from a fella who's, a streamer whose name I'm going to butcher. So I do apologize if I get the pronunciation wrong. This is Marouane Afukane. I'm guessing it's like, African pronunciations. I'm assuming, as opposed to Afukane. I don't know. Anyway, so apologies if I butchered your name. I butcher everybody's name. I call Timothy Appling Timothy Appalling all of the time, which is just the best punk name. It's like Johnny Rotten, so Timothy Appalling. Absolutely fantastic. So anyway, hi Mr. Nick, what's your thoughts about tapping on in the other strings other than the first string? Can play just from the wrist or need to add the flick, because the tone is not the same. I feel like you can do either with this. Let's go to the close-up cam, right? So playing with just the wrist with this kind of movement and this brush pull off will give us a particular tone, like so. When we start to add the flick that Marouane is talking about, where we add this aggressive pull off, I still think you can do that. I think you can still do it, but I would suggest that I would let the tone be your guide. If you want that big, really aggressive, meowing kind of tone, you can absolutely add the flick, but you can play just from wrist. There's nothing stopping you from playing this wrist only movement. Any given string. So yes, you absolutely can do both, I would say, and I think it's a perfectly viable thing to do both. So yeah, it's a great question though, very, very good. It's great to have you on board as well. Thanks for coming and joining us. Who else do we have? Sacred Godslayer. One thing for friends who are new to that technique, no one prevents you from tapping a note on a string that is different from the one you're playing. You know what it is? We didn't actually touch on that. That's a really great observation from our resident shredder. I totally agree with this. There's nothing stopping you from tapping a note that is on a different string to the one you're playing on. So if you're playing on the B string, like this, you can tap the E string. And it's actually a great way to transition. You know, it's a great way to transition to another string. Or you can just play that note and you can get some really cool, like, jumps, some big interval jumps by tapping on a string that you're not playing. That's really, really cool. I actually do this quite a lot myself, where I'm doing this like, two-finger rudiment that I'll do quite often. Wow. Here what I'm doing is I'm tapping, again, that pentatonic scale, where it's like third, minor third, fourth, fifth. Tap the minor seven. And then tap again with the third finger on the root. I can move the third finger by a string to get this fourth interval. So I get this. So it becomes this. You'll see me do quite a lot up here. Again, it just adds a little bit of extra kind of extra melodic dimension to this. So you know what it is? That's a really great observation, right? It just money. That's one of the things I love about these streams is I come in here with a topic in mind. But you guys are just really great at like helping us guide this stream into something that's useful for you. So I love your comments. Thank you so much for you know, letting me come and do this with you guys. It's a pleasure. It's absolutely a joy. So listen, we're going to play a little bit longer. If you want this backing track, you can get the backing track at this. Not that link. That's the Danny Gill lesson. You can get at this link. You can get the backing track from tonight's stream. It is our modern prog backing track. Funnily enough, from our scene, it has Pliny on the thumbnail. So there you go. Although I think we're going to get in trouble for that because they don't like us using artists' pictures for thumbnails. Whatever. Doesn't really matter. It's still there, but you can go and get it at this link. I think it sounds like that modern prog sort of thing, which is something I'm really into. But yes, I'm going to play a little bit more for you guys. In the meantime, I want to thank you for coming on board. Thank you for joining us. It's been a lot of fun. We're going to continue this discussion next week. I think we'll do some more tapping because the tapping has been really good and we've only scratched the surface with this. So, hey, more tapping to come. So in the meantime, thanks for having me. My name is Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive GI+. Don't forget, we have an exclusive Danny Gill lesson for you. Down below, click the link down below where you can go and get it. Non-members can get this for a week, members can get it forever. It's a really great lesson, shows you how to create a solo, and I mean solo as in unaccompanied solo piece of music using tapping. And Danny's the man. Why wouldn't you want a Danny lesson? Danny's great. So anyway, go get it. My name's Nick Jennison. See you next week. Myself up. I'm gonna do that lick I was talking about, the pentatonic one. You carried away there, came off the fretboard a couple of times. My name is Nick Jennison, Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. This is what you get as part of your GI Plus membership.
My name is Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from Fusion Maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful. Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.